Thank you very much, Kevin. And you took quite a lot of information from my talk, but thanks a lot. So, spinal cord.
Sorry.
No. Spinal cord injury can strike each of us at any time. And my lab, as Kevin said, is now working on spinal cord injury for over 20 years. And presently, there are millions of people affected by spinal cord injury worldwide. Thousands of new cases are added each year. The victims are often young, and based on the aging of the population, society has to support these patients for a long time. And despite of centuries of research into this area, as Kevin said, no satisfactory treatment is available. And the question is why? Here you see actually, so reality looks like this. Here you see actually some announcement, mostly from the last month, about breakthroughs in spinal cord injury. When I joined 1999, the lab of Jerry Silver as a postdoc, who is a renowned spinal cord injury researcher, I actually participated regularly in the biggest annual neuroscience meeting. And every year we heard about breakthroughs, but the problem was that the following years there was no follow-up story about it. And therefore, the question now remains, why is there no satisfactory treatment? And here is, and the reason lies within its complexity. The complexity is based on the multifactorial origin of this disorder. Meaning, what you see here is actually that the various cell types and scientific areas, some of them are just showed here, are causing degeneration, failure, and spinal cord injury. And this shows the complexity of regeneration processes and why spinal cord injury is not a simple issue to solve. So the course of the scientist was and still is in this field the classical bottom-up approach. And this works like that. So we have the problem, in our case spinal cord injury. Then the researcher takes one item out of this complex process. This can be a gene or protein family, or a cell type, and designs and the subsequent experiments actually are used to collect data on that one item, what he's or selected, to identify relevant information and interaction about this item. As I said, so this works nicely when there is little initial knowledge, which we had maybe in the mid of the last century. The course of discovery is driven by the experiments, meaning that the results are highly reliable, or because each extension step is experimentally confirmed. However, this approach, which is still used, only used in the spinal cord injury field, has a problem. If in case there's too much knowledge out there, what I do believe is right now, for a century now, or the case, there is a scaling problem. So I do believe that that an alternative approach is required, which is a top-down process. Here we still have this unknown problem, spinal cord injury, but in the first step, a knowledge pool is designed, which contains all information from that field, from the spinal cord injury field. And the subsequent experiments are actually used to weed out all unnecessary or unimportant information to then finally gather the information, the important information and relationships. This approach only works when the knowledge pool is large enough to encompass the solution, which I do believe that this is the case right now. It is possible. The course of discovery is driven by the information and results within the knowledge pool. There is no bias by human preference and no limitation by human comprehension. So, therefore, we propose that such a top-down process is required to actually unravel the complexity of spinal cord injury and regeneration failure. However, to do that, we need to get an answer to that question. What is a feasible metric for the complexity of the problem? The molecules that characterize and determine the function and powering up the machinery of the cell are actually the respective and executive proteins. They causing the desired effects and reactions. So therefore, the proteins in a cell are the workers, whereas the genes and the DNA are rather the managers. And this was the reason why we decided to focus on the proteome. When we decided to go this path, a good friend of mine asked me, if you want to do that, how many and which proteins participating in the events of spinal cord injury? And when I had no answer, and just to be clear, nobody had or still has an answer to that question in the spinal cord injury field. He continued to tease me, what am I doing the entire time? This even motivated me more to focus now on the proteins. And as all of you know, information also on the proteins are continuously accumulated in natural language texts, for example, in publications. And therefore, we started 14 years ago to mine this data. How did we do that? We actually developed a prototypic, I would like to end this prototypic program suite, which we called Regeneration Data Mining Project. At that time, so what this program is doing is actually collects all protein names from abstracts and titles from publications collected in PubMed, classified under the mesh term nerve regeneration. And the program is doing that by comparing each word from the titles and abstracts to UniProt, which we have heard is a protein database, as all of you know anyhow. So we ended so we had a list then for 1,500 proteins, and then we removed the false positives and duplicates. Our final seed list had a number of 1,358 proteins. We used this seed list to generate a protein-protein interaction network by actually using another database in that time called BIND. And we did this by taking, for example, the first protein from the seed list and searched in BIND for its binding partners. And then and the identified binding partners were then used again as, in the search in BIND, and we did this in 6 odd degrees. We also forced the program that these proteins are uniquely named within our interaction lab. So we visualized our interaction network using Cytoscape and use several plugins for graph analysis. And the results which we got out of here were actually confirmed in experiments. As I said, this was a prototypical program suite. It had actually a precision of 86%, a recall of 65%, and an estimated error rate of 1% at that time. And we started this program was this project 2005, and it was published in 2007. So when we classified these 1,358 proteins using gene ontology terms, the result cooperated with our original observation that a wide variety of biological, biochemical, and cellular processes, such as integral to membrane processes, signal transduction, development, DNA transcription, apoptosis, immunology, and even proteins from cell organelles such as ER, mitochondrial Golgi, and ribosomes are involved in regeneration ER events. And this ER result assured us to be in good agreement with our original observation that the complexity lies within this multifactorial or factorial processes. We started to manually scale through our list of 1,300 proteins and identified in search of proteins which were only cited with one or two publications, because they might have been overlooked in regards of their role in regeneration processes. So our attention was caught by osteopontin, which appeared only with two publications. Here we identified also manually that CD44 is a binding partner for osteopontin, and CD44 did not appear in our list. But as you can see, both proteins are investigated in the central nervous system via research field, but an interaction between both was just known in the cancer or research field. This interaction was completely new to the central nervous system research field. We wanted to investigate whether this interaction is important in axonal growth processes. So therefore, we used the technique which was introduced called DNA enzymes. This is a knockdown technology. DNA enzymes, which you see here, the two main structures, are single-stranded DNA molecules which are able to specifically cut any mRNA, and in our case, osteopontin mRNA, in our case, CD44 mRNA. So the advantage of that technique, compared to antisense or siRNA you might have heard of, is that these DNA enzymes have high specificity for the target, are naturally internalized, stable in vivo for 2 to 3 days, and have low production costs. When we employed now these DNA enzymes to neuronal cells, which are known to express CD44, and plated these cells on osteopontin, we observed that the DNA enzyme-treated cells have limited capabilities to initiate and elongate a characteristic long axon, which we observed in cultures which were treated with an inactive DNA enzyme or left untreated, as you can see here. But here these axons are missing. And this observation was statistically significant. So our program, the RDMP, helped us to identify such interaction to be involved in the regeneration of axonal growth processes. As we are further interested in identifying molecules, new molecules or new proteins, we actually pinpointed seedless proteins within our network. Here you see actually subnetworks, and when we were focusing on the inner circle of these subnetworks, we were able to identify glia fibrillaric acidic protein, GFA, P, or MAPK. These are two proteins which are most popular in the spinal cord injury field, and they are heavily investigated. So our we thought that then the next neighbors should also be of importance, and we were able to identify PS gamma and FH3 domains, GBR2-like-3 as next neighbors to GFAP, and SOS as next neighbor to MAPK. None of these proteins have been at that time investigated or even looked at after spinal cord injury, which is actually what we did, and we used a model of spinal cord injury called contusion injury model. Here, a rod, which is part of the computer-controlled infinity horizon impactor, induces a blunt injury to the spinal cord after the vertebrates have been removed in animals. As controls, sham animals are used, which do not receive such an injury, but endure the rest of the surgery. The contusion injury was used as a model because it reflects best what happens in humans. So the animals were then sacrificed at different time points, and the lesion site was cut out and used for further analysis. And in our case, we did a quantitative RT-PCR. And here's the result. Actually, you can see that PS gamma and SOS show a peak expression after 3 hours, whereas SH3 GR-vitro-like-3 after 6 hours in animals which received a contusion injury compared to the sham animals. So here again, our predicted proteins from that RDMP turned out to be really participating in spinal cord injury processes and actually at the immediate early time point. Here you see now the a total view of our interaction network. Every dot is a protein, every edge is an interaction. As darker the colors of these nodes are, as closer these proteins are to the C-twist protein, and as bigger the nodes are, as more information, mostly from publications, are known about that protein. But as you can see already here, this interaction network, just based on protein-protein interactions, is already intractable to human reasoning. And so therefore, reality caught up to us. In spite that the RDMP helped us to identify very promising candidates interactions, it turned out to be insufficient, mainly of course the data analysis are required was not sophisticated enough. Therefore, and too much human intervention was required. And this was the reason why we actually started a collaboration with the Hunter Group at the University of Colorado. The Hunter Group developed at that time the Hunterizer, a program which was interesting to us because it excels into the question, what is important in the biomedical domain? The Hunterizer integrates experimental data with the knowledge network to make relevant assertions. And how is that done? It's actually the tool builds this knowledge network from a wide variety of external sources. Including natural language text, ontology, and various databases. The information from these external sources are then collected by reading experts. Reasoning experts infer this knowledge by adding semantic relations, and the final result is then confirmed by was supported by a reliability estimation. The developed knowledge network not only contains some information on protein-protein interactions, but also on functions and other relations. And these results are confirmed by a confidence score. Originally, the Hunterizer was used to analyze microarray data from craniofacial development. So we had to modify it to work with proteomics results from animals which received a contusion injury compared to sham animals. These groups were sacrificed at different time points. From each time point, a data network was generated, which was then integrated with the knowledge network via a Pearson correlation. The relevant assertions are visualized in Cytoscape and analyzed with Reno Dual. Here you see now our results. We were able to identify between 1,600 and 1,900 proteins. Of these, approximately 1,200 proteins over the time points were quantified, and of these, 250 to 1,000 proteins were differentially expressed. And here you see two super networks generated from this data. One after 1 hour, the other after 8 weeks, the two corner time points of our study. And the colorization, the intensity of colorization actually shows the significance of these data from the injured animals compared to sham animals. There are several ways to analyze these super networks. I will talk about two ways my lab used. The first was the cluster analysis. Here, a program clusters our proteins actually based on similar expression patterns into five distinct clusters. The first one contained proteins which did not show any difference between sham and contused animals. In cluster two, there are proteins involved which show an immediate earlier response to the injury, whereas cluster 3, 4, and 5 contain proteins which are actually reacting quite late to the injury. We were focusing on cluster 2 because it contains the majority of proteins, at least by number, had a clear difference between sham and contused animals, and because it reacted immediately earlier, we were actually focusing on the 1 hour time point. And here you see this 1 hour time point again. And as you can imagine, it is still difficult to navigate and analyze this interaction network. And therefore, we used a tool which was also generated in Larry Hunter's group from Carsten Gör called RIMU-DUI. This tool is able to untangle these large, dense biological networks by actually filtering out important or interesting nodes and edges, and to generate a subnetwork. When we were focusing on the cluster 2 genes, we identified a protein which is called AHSG, or 15A, and we generated such a subnetwork by using, on the one side, familiar association called for me a familiar association about called extracellular space from the gene ontology term cellular component, and a new term exon guidance from the KEK database. Next neighbor analysis reveals that fetuin A can directly be associated with two exon guidance via a protein called PPP3CB. This protein shows also an upregulation after 1 hour to 48 hours, so it fits quite nicely into our hypothesis. And here you see the known functions of fetuin A. And if you read through them, you will find that there is no exon guidance among them. So we were actually able with the analyzer and RIMU-DUI to add a new function, in particular for spinal cord injury. In another approach, we to analyze our quantified proteins, we actually automatically assigned anatomical structures, biological pathways, and cell types to these proteins by using GeneSet. GeneSet is a GeneSet is a gene expression atlas of the developing and adult mouse brain. So we had to translate our rat proteins to the mouse mouse genes, and we did this first to compare our list of proteins to UniProt and confirm the results using CABI. Then we assigned rat genes to the rat proteins and appointed mouse genes to the rat genes. This result was confirmed using the sequence ontology. And when we had our mouse genes, we were actually able then to associate cell types as well as anatomical structures. The cell types were confirmed from gene set using the GO term gene expression and the cell ontology and the anatomical structures by using Uberon. The result was that 20 proteins were able to associate to neurons, 11 to glia cells, 5 to vascular cells, and 2 to ependymal cells. As we are also interested in what kind of pathways these proteins are involved, we used another ontology, the pathway ontology. And with this aid, we were able to annotate 8 proteins from the 20 proteins associated to neurons to 35 pathways. The same, so 6 proteins from the 11 associated to glial cells to 35 pathways, and 3 proteins from the 5 associated to vascular cells to 22 pathways. We use then the proteins from these pathways to compare back to our quantified proteins. Then the numbers, yeah, increase, and this lack of coverage was based on that a good number of mouse genes were not covered in gene cell. So when we now analyzed this result, we actually identified SMARCy1. SMARCy1 caught our attention because it showed a clear upregulation at 48 hours, and it was participating only in one pathway, the SWI, SNF familiar mediated chromatin remodeling pathway. And the other functions of SMARCy are DNA RNA binding, brain development, and dendritic growth. So in this example, we used again the RENAL-2i, where we used the 48-hour super network from the analyzer and analyzed it with RENAL-2i. In this case, we used the familiar association from the RED genome database pathway, the chromatin remodeling pathway. And we added some new terms such as transcription factors from the gene ontology, biological pathways, and exon guidance again from CAG. Next neighbor analysis revealed that SMARCy1 could be directly associated to clusterine. Clusterine is part of the positive regulation of NF-kappa-B transcription factor activity, and next neighbor analysis of clusterine revealed a direct connection to exon guidance, again via PPP3CB and also to MAPK. Furthermore, there is a connection to negative regulation of NF-kappa-B. What the analyzer and RENAL-2i did at that time was actually to reveal a chain of events from chromatin remodeling, which was quite quite early during the biological and biochemical processes, to exon guidance via specific transcription factor regulation. This chain of event was and still is not investigated in the spinal cord injury field in this combination. So we were actually able we modified the analyzer to work within the spinal cord injury domain, and we added some more databases and ontologies and an automatic inference filter which helped us to reveal and to identify 5 distinct protein clusters, associate proteins to anatomical structures and pathways and cell types, and gave us a new prediction of the chain of events within the spinal cord injury response, which were not known. But what is missing in this tool right now is actually text mining and NLP to enrich this analyzer with literature-based knowledge. And this is something where Ivo is focusing on doing this hackathon. In summary, one can say that this approaches, in comparison to what happened so far in the spinal cord injury field, helped the scientists, so me, quite fast to identify relevant and interesting protein-protein interaction and to investigate them in the vet lab. However, I can tell you now that I understand much more that for a satisfactory treatment in spinal cord injury, required is an even more comprehensive tool. And in particular, so the architecture must be differently And one part of the, in this architecture should be to compare animals with limited regeneration capabilities, such as humans, with animals which are able to, rather have functional regeneration skills, such as lamb the eel. So the take-home message is that the combination of bioinformatics with wet lab science is quite unusual for the spinal cord injury field. And it is, and these two need to work closely together. And in spite of that statement, I do believe that it is the most promising strategy to find actually to evaluate or to elucidate regeneration failure and find a satisfying cure for spinal cord injury. And as I'm, as I would like to say, if anybody is interested in these projects, please contact me. I'm also in the process of founding a company, so if anybody wants to be an investor or know somebody, please also contact me. And I would like to thank you, my collaborating partners, in particular, of course, the funding agencies. And I would like to thank you guys for your attention.